Hello, I'm Dr. Augustine Choi, Dean of Weill Cornell Medicine. Thank you for joining us for this installment of our three-part series, answering questions about the COVID-19 vaccine. The COVID-19 vaccine is the best tool we have to bring this pandemic to an end. And as we will learn today, it's safe and has gone through extensive development and testing. We will be joined by Dr. Kristen Marks, Associate Professor of Medicine in the Division of Infectious Diseases. Dr. Marks has been leading the medical center's vaccine trials. Weill Cornell Medicine is committed to protecting you, your loved ones, our patients, and our community. Thank you for putting your trust in us to keep you informed. Dr. Marks, take it away.
Thank you, Dean Choi. Let's get started with the Q&A. Here are some of the most frequent questions that we've been hearing as medical professionals regarding COVID-19 vaccine safety. What safety measures and testing went into development of the vaccines? Vaccine studies are done in different phases. Each of the vaccines authorized for emergency use by the FDA went through several phases of study. In phase one, the vaccine was given to a small number of generally healthy people to assess its safety at increasing doses and to get early information about how well the vaccine works. Since there were no safety issues in phase one studies, phase two studies proceeded and included more people. Various dosages were tested on hundreds of people. In phase three, the vaccines were administered to thousands of people in randomized placebo-controlled studies involving diverse populations of adults and later adolescents. They included people with medical problems known to be associated with more severe COVID. The phase three studies compared how well the vaccine works to placebo. At Weill Cornell, we helped conduct the Moderna phase three trial. This generated the data on how well the vaccine worked, which is known as its efficacy, as well as additional important safety information. These studies gave us a good picture that the vaccines were safe with just mild side effects that occur in the day or two after the vaccine as the immune system responds to the vaccine. It's important to note that the FDA advised on all phases of these clinical trials and that their monitoring continues after a vaccine has been approved or authorized for emergency use. After authorization, vaccine safety monitoring is a federal government responsibility shared by the FDA and the CDC, along with other agencies involved in healthcare delivery. The systems put in place to continue to monitor safety have allowed for the detection and quantification of the risk of extremely rare vaccine side effects. It's important that medical professionals and those receiving the vaccine know about side effects that occur, even if very infrequent, so that proper medical treatment is available if they are to occur. An example of this is the rare case of allergic reactions that have occurred with the mRNA vaccines. While the risk is low, 1 in 200,000 or so, people are asked to remain at the vaccine site for an additional 15 or 30 minutes after vaccination based on their own allergy history. As another example, we learned that women younger than 50 should be aware of the risk of blood clots with low platelets after vaccination with the Johnson & Johnson vaccine. Again, the risk is low, about 7 cases per million vaccinations in women under 50, and much lower for men or older women. But because it is serious, we want women and their doctors to be aware of it. COVID-19 vaccines have undergone and will continue to undergo the most intensive safety monitoring in U.S. history. It remains clear that getting vaccinated prevents severe illness, hospitalizations, and death. With the Delta variant, this is more urgent than ever. COVID-19 vaccination is a safer and more effective way to help build protection than getting COVID itself. What does emergency use authorization mean? An emergency use authorization is a way to facilitate the availability and use of medical countermeasures, including vaccines, during public health emergencies. For an EUA to be issued for a vaccine, first, the FDA must determine that the known benefits outweigh the known and potential risks of the vaccine. This comes from the information obtained in clinical trials. Second, there must be adequate manufacturing information to ensure quality and consistency. In the case of the three vaccines available in the U.S., the FDA cited strong evidence that the vaccines prevent COVID illness as the reason for approving them for emergency use. What are the vaccines made of? All vaccines available in the U.S. work to stimulate the immune system to recognize a SARS-CoV-2 viral protein called the spike protein. Having an immune response to this viral protein can prevent infection or reduce the severity of infection for people who come into contact with the SARS-CoV-2 virus. The Pfizer, BioNTech, and Moderna COVID-19 vaccines are messenger RNA vaccines. These vaccines contain the mRNA code that instructs cells in the body to make spike protein. They're basically recipes. When vaccinated, the body produces copies of the spike protein, which alone does not cause disease, and the immune system learns to react defensively, producing an immune response against SARS-CoV-2. Other components of the vaccines include lipids. Their main role is to protect the mRNA and provide somewhat of a greasy exterior that helps the mRNA slide into the cells that are near the injection site. They also contain some other inactive ingredients like salts and sugars to help keep the vaccine stable in storage and in our bodies. Viral vector vaccines use a modified version of a different virus known as an adenovirus to deliver important instructions to our cells. The Johnson & Johnson vaccine uses a modified and harmless version of an adenovirus as a shuttle to deliver the DNA gene sequence to produce the spike protein in our cells. This incompetent adenovirus cannot reproduce itself. Once it enters the cells, the DNA material within it travels into the nucleus. The cells take it through the natural steps to make the spike protein. The spike protein produced is displayed on the cell surface so the immune system can react to it. This viral vector vaccine also contains some other inactive ingredients like salts and sugars to help keep the vaccine stable in storage and in our bodies. Can the vaccine change my DNA? mRNA vaccines do not affect or interact with our DNA in any way. mRNA never enters the nucleus of the cell, which is where DNA is kept. In addition, after the protein piece is made, the cell in the area where it was given breaks down the mRNA instructions and gets rid of them naturally. The adenovirus in the Johnson & Johnson vaccine does not reproduce, and like mRNA vaccines, does not change our genetic code. It cannot integrate into or become part of our DNA. If these vaccines are so good, why is the method for making them brand new? Luckily, the technology for these vaccines was already in development for other preventative investigational vaccines. Those vaccines were tested in human clinical trials. It's not brand new. This is a real success story, actually. As part of the response to COVID, government agencies, academia, pharmaceutical companies, and others all work together to develop a strategy for prioritizing and speeding the development of the most promising vaccines. This saved a lot of time. And one thing particular that saved time was the scale-up of the manufacturing capacity. This was done before the trials were even completed. It's not a miracle these vaccines are so good at preventing COVID. Tremendous effort over decades related to vaccine development and study of viruses prepared scientists for this moment. But it is a blessing that they work so well.